truthfully.
Fluent Spanish, todo está bien chévere.
Bien chévere.
Is that right, mama? Yeah, because I got my shaking room.
Everybody's got a thing, but some don't know how to handle it. Always reaching out in vain, just taking the things not worth having. But don't you worry about a thing. Don't you worry about a thing, mama, 'cause I'll be standing on the side when you check it out. You say your style of life's a drag and that you must go other places, but just don't you feel too bad when you get fooled by smiling faces. But don't you worry about a thing. Don't you worry about a thing, mama, 'cause I'll be standing on the side when you check it.
Broken down and tired of living life on the merry-go-round, and you can't find a fighter, but I see it in you, so we gon' walk it out. Move mountains, we gon' walk it out and move mountains. And I'll rise like the day. I'll rise unafraid. I'll rise up, and I'll do it 1,008 times again. And I'll rise up, I like the way. when the silence isn't quiet, and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe. And I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll take the world to its feet. Move, I won't dance, bring it to its feet. For that we have each other. I will rise a thousand times again, and we'll rise up.
Great pleasure on behalf of all of the Women in Lighting team to announce Natalie Rosso and the initiative Light Reach as one of the two projects in the initiative category of the first ever WIL Awards. And these are two initiatives that our jury felt deserve some special recognition. So we wanted to have a chat with Natalie and give her an opportunity to explain a little bit about the initiative Light Reach. So hi, Natalie.
Hello, Sharon. Well, so Light Reach is a homegrown from the lighting community initiative. It happens to be women-led, and it has an ambitious vision and a mission without limits. And basically, what it wants to do is bring lighting to communities who need light, and help the lighting community bring light to communities. So it's a two-way street.
Is there something in particular that prompted you to create it?
Yes, it's actually been a long time in the process. I started working on a project in Haiti several years ago with Lighting Designers Without Borders. And it turns out that when the year I volunteered, the partner organization asked us to help them with an electrification program in informal settlements. And it turns out that I had done pretty extensive personal research on lighting for informal settlements, investigating, exploring different solar lighting options. So I was able to, first of all, convince them that you can bring lighting in the short term, and you don't have to wait for long-term electrification solutions. And I also had developed a three-level lighting system with portable lights for individual domestic use, floodlights, security for pathways and access, and then street lights for public spaces. So in a way, the program in Haiti was kind of a test ground for the model, and it worked really well. The beauty of using a solar light as a resource is that it really becomes a shared resource for the community, and they can you know, store it if there is a natural disaster that's going to come, and then they can redeploy it really easily. So it really helps community resilience, it prevents community displacement, and it just helps, you know, placemaking. So it worked really well. And when I presented that project at the Lumen Awards in New York, some people came to me from our lighting community and said, oh, you know, I like what you're doing, and can I help in any way? And I realized that what I needed was not help from my peers to do this work, but I actually needed to help them do the work and get engaged, because I could see some interest, but, you know, why reinvent the wheel? So that's how I came to sort of design Lightreach as a system. It's on our end, we provide all the logistics. There is multiple program that are expensible, replicable project templates. We train volunteers, we provide them with the equipment, the templates they need for workshops, and we support with all the logistics. So that's how it's started, and that's how it's going now.
So would you say that you need do you need financial support from the lighting industry rather than, you know, just people that are interested to help, or is it a little bit of both?
Oh, yes, we need both. But I think that the buy-in from volunteers it's already there. But we do need financial support. And while I'm very grateful because we already have very generous donors and corporate sponsors, in my opinion, what we really need is a cultural shift in our industry. I think we are really far behind other disciplines in terms of social work and social engagement. So as a team at Lightreach, we are really working on sensitizing our community and educating people about philanthropic practices. I think that once we launched in Puerto Rico with a proof of concept, now we're working in Lebanon in the pandemic context. So soon we're going to be able to show the lighting design that we do, because we do landscape lighting with security lights, and we are going to light landmark buildings with security lights. So I think that once our community sees that, they will be inspired and we'll get support, which we absolutely need, because otherwise Lightreach can't continue.
Can't happen. So that was going to be my question, really, is the experience of running sort of projects like this, so the lighting projects, has it changed the way you think about lights itself?
Well, actually, I think it's the other way around. I think the way I think about light is why I'm doing these projects. I really firmly believe that light is a right, and that lighting is about life after dark, and that lives in the dark matter. All those things are really what drove me to develop this work. And also, it's, you know, I think we need to live in a world where a lot more people, if not everyone, knows a lot more about light. The science of light is not rocket science, and working with communities in Haiti, people understand very quickly CRI, luminance, because they work, you know, at home. And I think that there's also a lot of art and culture in their daily lives. So I think that applying light to those very almost kitchen table applications and personal, you know, artistic enrichment is important, and is what we can do. Light is a powerful medium, and I think that we should use it to help communities around the world.
Well, we totally agree with you.
Yeah, I suspect that much.
Okay. Thank you very much for your time and explaining a bit about the project. Obviously, I think we had along the bottom of the screen, lightreach.net. That's the website where people can find out more about the initiative and the projects you're involved in, and also donate or contact you in some way. So thank you.
Thank you.
Is there any wonder why I'm shining so tonight? Is there any wonder why I'm...
On behalf of the whole Women in Lighting team, it gives me great pleasure to announce Manal Kahale and the initiative Light for Lebanon as one of the two projects in the initiative category of the first Women in Lighting Awards that our jury felt deserved special recognition. We wanted to give Manal an opportunity to explain a little bit about Light in Light for Lebanon. So we've invited her along for a quick chat. So, hi.
Hi. First of all, thank you so much for this fantastic news and being part of a platform that puts lighting designer and the great and their great initiatives and projects and anything that pushes the industry forward is already an amazing recognition and achievement by itself. So thank you.
Can you tell us a bit about Light for Lebanon and obviously the events that sort of caused, prompted you to start it?
So it all started after the third largest non-nuclear explosion in Beirut. And it was 2 weeks that were really, really harsh. We were running around trying to help out and then being inspired by friends and people that just try to bring their industries to make a change in the country was very inspiring. So after a couple of weeks, I remembered my thesis professor, Nathalie Roseau, who is now my partner in this project. And she immediately told me, yes, it can be done for Beirut. Let's get to it. And this is where we took the model from LightReach, which is a three-scale model, which is all quick deployable, portable lights, solar lights in three scales, and trying to brighten up Beirut as well as educate people that there is a different solution for a country that has that much damaged infrastructure, electric infrastructure. And ever since, we've had amazing people join in on the team and raise funds and get on the ground and act like lighting designers, not only suppliers, but bringing in as much as we can projects for community, because that was the fastest way we could actually make a stronger impact and get people involved.
So would you say that the lighting industry has been very supportive to the initiative?
Well, for starters, that's how our team was formed. It was lighting designers that were passionate about it and wanted to make a change. So they became part of the permanent team trying to spread in their network. And also, that goes without a doubt, without a say, that women in lighting have been one of our greatest supporters. And putting us on the map has been more than helpful in terms of raising awareness too for solar lighting in areas that have, in areas of a devastation.
So would you say, I mean, obviously this is a massive experience for you as a designer to run an initiative like this. Does it make you think about light differently now than before the initiative?
Yes, honestly, very much. It's because this interaction with people that don't have light, first of all, shows you that there's the necessity of where you need it for safety, where do you need it for their use, their day-to-day use. I mean, we do know all that, but taking it from people who don't know the industry and hearing what they had to say, that changes a bit the way we see a design. And people from various neighborhoods also talking to them, because there's a mentality, especially in the Middle East, that people the brighter it is, the better it is. So actually, getting to that mentality and trying to shift it around by showing that the bare minimum with the contrast, and I won't get into details right now, but yes, it does change it.
So the project's had quite a sort of physical impact in terms of you being able to purchase solar lanterns and streetlights and floodlights and that kind of thing. Are you still open for donations?
Yes. And first of all, this recognition right now, this is going to be a very big help to help us raise some more funds, because we've received everything we've purchased and we're installing it, but the demand is becoming higher and the crisis and the fuel shortage is making people panic. So it's expanding very rapidly.
Okay, so where can people donate? Where's the best place to go?
The best place would be either on our social pages, like Instagram, on Light for Lab, on Light Reach's page as well, which is the main NGO, and this is their program, or on their website, LightReach.net.
Okay, LightReach.net, that's there. And also, I suppose we should mention, as you're wearing one, the profit from each of the Women in Lighting T-shirts that we sell goes directly to this initiative. That's why for us it's really wonderful that this initiative is the winner. We had no idea at the beginning with all these other amazing initiatives that it would be something that people wanted to recognise further, but it's obviously something that's quite close to our hearts. So we're really pleased.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for your time, and I hope to meet you in person someday in the future.
Yes, most definitely will. Thank you so much for everything.
Is there any wonder why I'm shining so tonight? Is there any wonder why
So again, I have the brilliant job on behalf of all of the Women in Lighting team to announce our next judges' favourite, and that is Lisa Reed in the USA. She's one of the two winners in the supporter category of the first ever Women in Lighting Awards that our jury felt deserved special recognition for her nomination. So we wanted to have a short chat with Lisa about support and being supported. So, hi, Lisa.
Hi, Sharon. Good to see you.
So, I guess the first thing we wanted to ask you is, when you came into the lighting industry, did you find it easy to get support yourself?
That's an interesting question. When I came into the lighting industry, I was really shy. And I also started my career in engineering. So in some ways, maybe I wasn't looking for support, but I will tell you that when I looked around, I didn't see any other women engineers in the firms where I worked. But in another way, I felt really supported. Sure, you know, I can name several people who really stepped in and helped me get started in my career. But that nagging feeling of always, you know, not really knowing what to do was there. And it's something I've tried to change in my career.
I think maybe sometimes it never quite goes away, but deep down inside. But obviously, the more people that support us through our journey, the better things are. So is there somebody you feel, or some people you would like to name check that you feel offered you support?
Sure. I mean, right out of college, Tom Brownlee of Brownlee Lighting helped me, just set me up and let me make phone calls and helped me find my first job. And then when I stepped into the door of the first firm where I worked, the engineer there immediately took me under his wing, Gary Chase, and, Jerry Solar. There's so many, you know, those are way back now. I'm getting old, but so many people stepped in and made a difference in my life. Yeah.
So how do you think we can actively support each other in our industry? Obviously, you've been nominated in this category and chosen because people feel that you are an excellent supporter. And how do you think we can do that for others?
I think for me anyway, it's been, if I see something that I don't like or didn't work well for me, I try to do something about it. And I'll tell you, partly, it's just talking about it. I started talking about things that I saw, and I didn't have the answers. I didn't know how to make them better. But when I started talking about it, then people started coming to me for support. And, you know, it sort of snowballed from there. So, to sort of bring that full circle, in my own firm, I have a lighting design firm that I started 10 years ago. And I really started it because I needed support as a working mom with new young babies. And it's something I've endeavored to provide for my team members, is that support and flexibility and the things that I needed when I was just starting out that I couldn't find anywhere else.
Yeah, I think when we say support, we immediately think of, you know, those people that are kind and help you on your way and give you advice. But it means all the other stuff as well, doesn't it? Like you say, a supportive employer and, you know, help when things go wrong. So that all those things are important. But so we know that, I mean, you support the ILD, you support WILD in the USA, you're supporting women in lighting, you're a successful lighting designer and a mum. So how do you kind of make sure that, you know, you have space for yourself within all of that?
Lighting design is my hobby. but really, I will, so besides just being imbalanced and loving what I do and doing lighting design all the time and calling that me time, I would say one thing I did a few years back is set aside a day that's just a no work day. So I actually don't ever do any work on Sundays, and it takes it off the table and, you know, frees me up to do whatever, relax or hang out. And another thing I would say, is, you know, maybe this is supporting someone else, but my dog makes me go out for walks twice a day. And that's something I like to do too.
Yeah, I think it's important to remember that we're not useful to others unless we are, you know, in a good place ourselves. But so just to sort of close, I mean, it's a big question and we tend to always ask it of people, but do you have a message for other women in lighting?
You know, I think there is an abundance of critics in the world, and I really like it when people step up and do something. And it really frustrates me that when you see someone doing something, immediately you see a whole horde of people standing around criticizing them for doing it wrong. And I would just say, you know, ignore the critics and just do something.
That's really good advice. We have a saying, I mean, I don't know if it's in the US as well, but when you put your head above the parapet, you get shot down. So this idea that, you know, if you do try and do something, there's people ready to shoot you down. But I guess that's the fundamental thing about support, isn't it? Is that we do need people to be positive to keep doing what we're doing. So congratulations on winning this award. It's been really nice to talk to you, and hopefully we'll meet you in person sometime soon in the future.
Yes, I hope so. Thank you so much. This is such an honor.
Is there any wonder why I'm shining so tonight? Is there any wonder why I speed like more?
So once again, I get the brilliant job of announcing another one of our winners in the first ever Women in Lighting Awards that our jury felt deserved some special recognition. So I get to announce Chiara Carucci, an Italian designer working in Sweden. And she's one of the two winners in the supporter category. So we're just going to have a short chat with Chiara about support. Hello.
Hello. So nice to see you. And thank you very much.
It's a lovely job telling people that they are chosen as one of our first winners. So can I just ask you, I mean, when you first came into lighting, did you find it easy to get support from other people?
Yeah, it was quite some time ago. We had no internet, no Facebook at the time. And so we would connect at fairs mostly and conferences in person. So it wasn't that easy, but it really helped me find this community spirit. Like just the in-person connection was awesome to feel how great our industry can be. At the time, we would connect and also learn from chosen people, mentors. So I have to say, we will learn a lot from them, not only about the profession, but also maybe about the intentions and attitude, and whether we like them or not, we will be forever grateful. And so I am to Marinella Barretta and Alessandro Reggiani, and especially Susanna Antico, I will be forever grateful to them. So now we have Zoom and Facebook and live events and so on. That's really, really great to connect each other all over the world like we are now. But I have to say, I really look forward to the next ILD conference in person. I can't wait.
That's the last time we saw you, wasn't it, at an in-person conference?
Yeah.
So how do you think we can actively support other people in our industry as individuals?
Well, I would say by just opening up and helping others as much as we can. And we don't have to feel the best at doing something in order to help others. It could be really small things, from preparing the talk for a colleague, as well as writing an article together, reviewing a project. And I have to say that all of these things that I'm mentioning, we have been doing with Women in Lighting Italy group. And it's so amazing that we can connect through Women in Lighting and support each other. Maybe another example is, again, mentoring, because I see today many, many young people growing very fast in their own companies and studio. But I think that we still can be available and really support each other by, again, mentoring and be kind and share not only our skills, but also attitude. I guess if we mentor, if we open up to others, we always see it coming right back at us, whether directly, whether as a great support to the industry. So it's an advantage for everyone, in my opinion.
Yeah, I always sort of remember like all the people that wrote back to me when I first wanted to start in lighting, and really appreciated that. So obviously when people write to you, you want to be able to do the same thing, don't you? You want to pay it on, pay it forward. So, I mean, we know that you're, yeah, give back. We know that you're involved in Women in Lighting Italy and the ILD Nordic section, and probably thousands of other things I don't even know about. How do you manage to make time that, you know, time for yourself and make sure that you have some space?
It's quite interesting, as I feel I don't really have a boundary in between what's my professional life and this other life that everyone is talking about. I don't know. When I was younger, I would always say lighting design is my profession, my passion, and my lifestyle. It was some sort of a motto. I think I have several articles closing with that line. And I was proud of it. Also, I think some people look up at me for this reason and found me available as a mentor, just for this reason. I feel my family is all of you. I had you guys so close for a very, very long time. And I mean, some of my mentees, I don't know, I want to mention Katia and Martina at least, they taught me so much. So I really believe lighting design industry is a very large family for me. So that's how I like to spend my spare time with and for. So my devotion and my passion, yes, is basically to lighting design. Of course, I have other interests, but that's just me. And obviously, there are so many women who have or want to have spare time for other things. To them, I wish best of luck and to get super organized with the way they spend the time. And if you need any organizational skills or advices, please get in touch with me because I'm also a control freak. So that way, maybe I can help.
Maybe the fact that your passion for light spills into everything that you do is what makes you such a sort of unique, you know, supporter of other people, I would say. So just to finish, do you have, apart from get in touch with me if you want organizing, do you have a message for women in lighting?
I would just like to thank you all because you gave a great opportunity to connect everywhere in the world, share our experiences, discuss matters that we would not shed the light upon otherwise. And I would really invite everyone not to give up, but just ask for help rather. Also to maybe continue share stories through the website. So your interviews are really important for everyone. And maybe I would like to thank you, the supporters, but also the people who are writing the blogs, especially the Mind block. That is also another thing that we didn't have the chance to discuss before. So our health and well-being is relevant for doing the profession that we do.
And I will really love to thank Okidoki, particularly Jannike Wiglander, who's a super great inspiration for me.
Yeah, so maybe last message is also to open up to other women, not necessarily in other industry, because I realized that my best project in the latest year were with other women. So successful project with the landscape architect from Eskilstuna and a researcher here in Italy, Rosangela, I want to mention, is like so great to open up to women and not to be sexist. It's just give opportunity and chance to other women to be in the spotlight with us.
Thank you. I hope we see you somewhere in the world soon.
The same. I can't wait to hug you all.
Is there any wonder why I'm shining so tonight? Is there any wonder why I speed like motorbikes? Is there any wonder how you make me feel alright? Is there any wonder why my energy's so bright? incredible. I'm traveling like the light.
Drown!